Okay, we'll come to order if you stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you'd remain standing for a moment of silence, please.
Take a moment of silence for the four firefighters and three police officers that have passed since our last board meeting.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, if I could just take a moment of time while we're talking about people we've lost, and I'd like Fire Marshal Johnson to say a few words about Charlie Allen, our photographer, longtime volunteer here at Sedona Fire District. If you'd like to say a few words.
Many of you folks probably can remember Charlie if we look at the board behind us. Not uncommon seeing him back here taking pictures when there were events going on. He was the gentleman who would climb up on the ladder because he always thought it was better a better shot to take the picture from the angle. I can tell you that near the end, before he retired, I'd get a little more uncomfortable as he'd climb up that ladder. Okay, but I just wanted to talk about Charlie a little bit. You know, I met Charlie back when he started in 1988, and I'll get better when I keep talking. But you know, one of the things that he helped me with, and Will Loesch and us with fire investigations, and not just within our fire district. Many times we'd go and help other agencies, and Charlie would show up. He was totally self-contained. I mean, he brought everything he needed with him when he came to the department, and when he showed up at a scene, and it was just great. And I got a couple examples of where I think he made a significant difference. And some of us remember the fire that we had out in the Back and Beyond, in which it was by a pool. The individuals had been in the process of having the building reskinned. It was stucco. There were some issues. Heavy rain occurred, and as a result, the fire was actually caused by an outlet failing that was on the outside of the wall. The insurance company didn't exactly agree with us. However, because of his documentation and the quality of the photography, it turned out that his photos were the only one they could find. And so as a result, it ended up a positive for the homeowner, and in my opinion, rightfully so. Another example is we had a little fire behind us at the Shadow Rock Apartments, in which we had an individual who I would, in my humble opinion, had some mental issues. He ended up wanting to start a fire by using gasoline throughout the building, actually put it in the tray that contained for the water overflow at a water heater. What he didn't account was when the water heater auto-lit, and of course it ignited. The gentleman ended up taking his own life on I-40 by taking on a Greyhound bus head-on. Again, he ended up getting a national award in 1998, and he was on the cover of AAAIF magazine. And I can go on and on about some of the things he did. But I think the other part of him that I think is really important you know, he was always there for us. At the beginning of a fire, it wasn't uncommon for him to have a bunch of pictures that he would end up giving everybody. So, you know, that history and the fact that he cared. And so, you know, whether it was a small fire, a wildland, and that, he would make sure that he got pictures of the guys and gals doing stuff. And then they would end up getting copies of those. When we had a party, a couple parties at Los Abrigados, I remember he produced I don't know how many pictures. And he made me drag that big old display that we had out that's like 4x8, that kind of angle, and set it up. And there must have been 100 pictures set up. And when at the end of the day, he told everybody at the end of the night, you can take them, they were all gone. So I think, you know, that's pretty important. He's the guy that kind of started our photos with the ID, with our ID pictures, made sure we were in proper uniform and spent the time to see that they were taken. You know, again, like for tonight, we have a family here with the promotion. If Charlie was here, he'd be here. The board's behind us, another good example. You know, he was pretty picky, and some days he'd almost drive me nuts, because he determined that the screen was not the right color, give him the right colors when he printed it with the printer. And he spent countless hours figuring out how to coordinate that and calibrate that to work. And he was right, because when they produced, the quality improved. And then that's just an example of Charlie. He was proud of his work in the Sedona Fire District. He was here for us when we needed him. He was truly part of the spirit of the district. I think Captain Kurtz made the comment at the board staff meeting this morning. He said his heart was with Sedona Fire. He'll be missed. I apologize.
I think that Fire Marshal Johnson's summary of Charlie Allen speaks for itself, but having only 4 years to know Charlie Allen, to watch him on that ladder every time, I had some similar concerns. But I can't tell you, the minute you met him, he says, "Chief, let's go." "Okay, where are we going, Charlie?" "We gotta get your picture. We gotta have a good picture for you, the newspaper one, you know? Looks like you're in high school." So I agreed on both accounts, and I went out and we took pictures and pictures and pictures. How about this lighting? We spent an hour and a half making sure we had the right picture, and I got some very nice pictures. And again, he provided me with a disc and all the photos. It's nice to have that piece of memory for me and history in my life. But not that long ago, after he kind of decided that he was done volunteering with us, we Gary lives down the street from him, and got all of the photos that he did. It was boxes and boxes and boxes of CDs that he made for our history. It will be forever captured, and someday someone's going to look at those pictures and be like, this is a treasure trove of history of Sedona Fire. So the staff here in the district has got a brick in Charlie's honor. It says, "Charlie Allen, SFD photographer. His heart was full of Sedona Fire, 1988 to 2014. We'll provide this to his family, and we have one that'll be displayed out in the patio forever to remember Charlie Allen and just truly the volunteer spirit and the man that he is. Is what has made Sedona Fire just so special in so many ways. So he'll be missed dearly, and we just say thanks to Charlie Allen. So thank you, Charlie.
That's quite a story for Charlie.
I'm going to hold off on the swearing in part for a minute. So
okay.
Sandy's got to run and get something for me.
Okay.
Because she's sweet.
We can always interrupt and come back. So would you like to ahead with the budget?
If you would like to do that,
we'll come back. Okay.
Certainly. Sorry, Josh and family. You get to stay for some more exciting stuff.
So, you want to go ahead?
We
need to open to public comments, but I think we ought to go ahead and talk first.
Yeah, certainly. Well, I think, I don't think we have to open to public comments yet. We can just go right into it, and then, unless there's anyone that wants to talk about it first, I guess. No one's wished to speak? Okay. So, Board, at the last month's meeting, we discussed our budget and our plans. You provided me some direction as it related to initiatives and concerns you may have had as it relates to the Sedona Fire District fiscal year 17 budget. We've programmed in all the issues that you brought forward and had concerns about, and went through the budget. We ended up at a $15,854,789 budget. That includes that three firefighters starting on October 1st that you spoke of, the other staffing increases that we talked about, a telecom person, a part-time person going to full-time in the admin. The Type 1 engine was initially, in last month's meeting, we talked about was $625,000. The apparatus committee continued to work through what we think we really need as an organization and was able to work through all of that, get the MESA spec, I believe, for pricing, and we're able to get that down to $590,000. So some savings there. The one thing we had to add, there's a $30,000 increase that we're carrying over about $30,000 worth of telecom that they're not able to finish up this year that will be carried over. So there's a zero cost to the levy part of the equation, but they're just not gonna be able to get some high priority jobs done in time. So we swept that over, and so you see an increase in this. So net, that's where we are.
And we have hard numbers now on health insurance, work comp, everything else.
Health insurance, work comp, all that stuff is, everything's in there. So there are no more matters to be addressed in there. That's the final number. We're prepared to publish this budget if you're so inclined. I've included in the packet the actual publication documentation that we do. Sandy takes care of that. is part of her publishing, and I think that's 21 days now that we have to publish it for, 20 days. So we'll do that as soon as the board directs us to do so, and then we'd be planning to come back to you in June for a public budget hearing, and then final approval of the budget if there are no further questions.
Okay. Well, we'll let the board digest that for a moment. If you want to come back, if you've got what you need, to go ahead and let these people off the hook so they don't have to sit through a budget meeting if they didn't want to. Because that's not what they came for, I don't think.
You're way too easy. Yes, stand by here. I'm just looking for the part where I got to add in Captain. Sorry, stand by. Trish is off this week, so this is a symptom of.
Oh yes, we'll send our well wishes to Trisha, who is injured and recuperating at home. So we hope she gets better quickly.
All right, we're going to go with it. All right, we are honored today to have Josh Wells with us. Josh Wells has been with Sedona Fire District, started as a shift cover reserve in 2005, hired as a full-timer just 6 weeks later, it looks like, became a certified paramedic in 2006. He's got a bachelor's degree from NAU, an associate's degree in fire science. He's been an active member of our organization with many unit citation awards for different rescues and slide fire and all kinds of things. And just been a great asset to the organization. Josh Wells is one of his claim to fame would be a training. Over 10,000? Where is he, Josh?
Yeah,
close to 15,000 now. People in CPR are being supportive in that, and he's got a history as a young person to where CPR has become important to him based upon experience with your grandfather. Was it in the? And so he found it at a young age that knowing CPR is important. It's made his life mission to include CPR as part of everyday language. Just a few months ago, we had an opportunity to go to the Capitol and provide some input on CPR in the schools legislation. And in true chief fashion, I delegated that and said, Josh would be perfect for that job. And so I sent him down to the Capitol with a couple other fire chiefs and he hobnobbed with the best of them down there, and I got some great pictures of him in different parts of the Capitol and different dignitaries and elected officials down there, and we're excited to see that the governor just signed that legislation just the other day and will be going into effect and helping further Josh's mission to continue the CPR mission that he has. It's just awesome. So we just offered a captain's promotional process just a few months ago. And Josh came out on top. He just did awesome, as did everyone in the process, but Josh did excellent, came out number one, and here we are a few weeks after the promotional process, the list gets posted, we're actually promoting him. So real quick timing, and it kind of came up fast, I think, and we'll talk about who he's replacing in a little bit as my chief's report. But so I'm honored to bring and present to you Captain Josh Wells, and we're gonna do a quick swearing in of your captain's oath, I think is what we do normally, right? I think so. All right. Come on up, Josh.
Josh, this is really good. I need you to. So, Josh, we're gonna get a chief badge here in about a second.
I think it's one of those days. So if there's any lack of preparation, it's completely upon me and the fact that I'm missing my right hand, Trisha. So, wow, it was a busy day. How many meetings we have today? About 12?
There you go.
That will start. All right, we're going to go slow and see if we can't make you assistant chief. We got to give you the real badge. Let's see what we got here. Just peddling badges on the side.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll give you a moment to say a few things as if we're waiting. We'll get that at the end for sure. So here we go. So I'm going to raise your right hand, Josh.
And then my brother's going to
Yep. We'll get him up here. So as we do the oath, then we'll call him up. How's that go? Does that work?
That works.
All right. Make sure I'm doing this right.
I, Captain Josh Wells. Do solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution and laws of the State of Arizona.
And the
Constitution and laws of the State of Arizona.
That I will bear the true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I will bear the true faith and allegiance to the same.
And defend them against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
And defend them against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
I pledge to uphold the mission and policies of the Sedona Fire District.
I pledge to uphold the mission and policies of the Sedona Fire District.
And I will faithfully and impartially discharge the duties.
And I will faithfully and impartially discharge the duties.
Of the office of captain.
The office of captain.
Of the Sedona Fire District.
Of the Sedona Fire District.
According to the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
All right, so this is the part where we would normally call your brother up and I give you a badge and have you pin. But in this case, we're going to have you say a few words because you asked. So here you go.
Yeah, I want to say a few words, mostly just gratitude for everybody that helped support me here. My family, you guys are awesome with. Jaden helped me and helped us study. And mom and dad, Aaron, Nana, Papa, Ezekiel, too, Amelie, for being good during study time. And of course, and Faith was amazing with holding down the house and being able to do so much so that I could commit to doing this and developing myself for this. And in turn, I'd like to pay it back to, and of course, the Sedona Fire District for everything they did. Specifically, my brothers on my former C-shift brothers, which ended at 7:30 this morning. Jarrett Tarver, he was my companion in battle. And we spent a lot of hours preparing. Several hours together, and we both ended up doing really well on the list. So thank you, Tarb. I really appreciate it. Thank you guys for showing up. And Captain Baker, he really poured a lot into us. And because of you, stuff happens. I mean, we put in the work, but you provided a clear path for it. And I really appreciate that, and it's a model to follow going into the position. And Chief Cochran, I'm excited to come to the shift, and I hope that I've been trained well. And of course, God for the grace and everything that he's given me to be here and to serve. My badge is here. So again, thank you very much. I'm only here because of all your support.
Thank you, Sandy. Thank you, Josh. Aaron, if you'd like to come up and pin your brother here. Aaron's an engineer in flag. Engineer and Flagstaff Fire. So here, you guys get right here so you can get a good picture. We want to get you so your family can see you guys, and I'll get out the way. Earning the right of privilege, or the privilege of being a captain. He's in charge of a station now, a crew, and a whole bunch of new stuff that we'll be putting on your plate. So I know you'll be up to the challenge. I know you got some great mentors here, and going to B shift, you're going to a good one. They're all good, but he's here, so we'll talk about them. So congratulations to you, yes. Captain Wells.
Thank you.
Go forth and serve. Thank you.
Captain Wells, we always wonder how we're going to remember certain milestones in our life. Today is the day your badge almost wasn't there.
It's close.
Forget it.
I checked the other day and made sure we had them all, so I knew they were there. Right side, back. I know exactly where it was.
All right. We'll come back to board business of the budget. So we have a budget put in front of us. Anybody have any comments to open or anything they want to discuss regarding the budget at this point? We've been doing it since January, I know, so.
Well, last time we really appreciated your budget presentation.
Thank you.
Very much, the PowerPoint. And I just wanted to, I realized we made a mention of salary adjustments, and yet we didn't spell them out very well. So I wanted to make sure that we are on the record for the decisions the board has made around the salary adjustments. As I went home that evening, I thought, oh my goodness, I hope staff didn't think we were adjusting them downward, you know, because we just used the word salary adjustment. But in actuality, we certainly came to the conclusion advice and of Chief and the work that you've done with staff, that there is a raise taking place, and it varies a little bit depending on which category. I don't know if you'd like to say something about that, Chief.
Well, through our meet and confer process, we worked through to look at comparable agencies and just kind of right size a few things and look at compression issues in different categories of our employees. Mm-hmm. And so we were able to take a look at that and create a salary adjustment for each of the positions in our organization, and some take effect in July, some take effect in January. There's some phasing in that goes on. I'm a strong believer in working smart and rewarding our folks that really do a great job, and there's a fine line between that. And I think we've done a great job balancing the workload, the expectation, the high level of service delivery that our folks provide on a daily basis, that the commitment to our community, all of that kind of gets filtered in, as well as looking at our comparables, what the market is for our positions. And so we looked at all that, and through many, you know, processes, through meet and confer and everything, looking at the big picture, we've came up to those conclusions. And I think each step that gets it, there's probably too many to really kind of juggle through and give you a play-by-play. I can probably pull it out if you really need me to.
No, but that's fine. You know, but the range, yeah, just to mention.
Yeah,
the
1-3% is the range that the salary adjustments are, depending on the rank.
Mm-hmm.
And so staff with a 1% starting in July, and some of the fire folks, operational folks, being 2-3% starting in January.
Mm-hmm.
With the
idea of spreading some of that, not having to impact this budget.
Correct. In order to make ends meet and make it all make sense, we had to look at typically in the past, we've always started in July for raises, and just based upon budget and a couple other constraints and trying to meet the overall goal and mission of everybody that, you know, in the organization, it made sense for some to start in the January timeframe. As well as looking at an increase for the firefighter paramedic. There's a paramedic stipend for the firefighter paramedic was also addressed as those folks are continuing to be busy. And again, look at the comparable agencies, what folks are getting compensated for in like agencies. So remaining competitive is important. Remaining relevant is important. I think we're working hard at that.
Uh-huh. And that was part, certainly, of my feeling good about these salary adjustments upward, is that we do want to remain competitive, that we want to retain our well-trained staff and our dedicated staff, and we want them to feel acknowledged for their competency and dedication, and we also want them to stay with us.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Very good. And I think the only other thing that I think that we, you know, we mentioned that this year there's no COLA because Social Security didn't get a raise. So it's excellent that there is a salary adjustment taking place, but that since most of it doesn't start until January, we felt, if I'm saying, I think, Ty, you mentioned that since it doesn't start till January, we don't then want to do a COLA in next July, because that would be just 6 months later, if indeed there is any COLA for Social Security next year.
And if that's the board's pleasure, that is mm-hmm. the that has always been the prerogative of the board as it relates to COLAs. And as I kind of think I mentioned before, that the groups, staff included, would, you know, understand if that's the direction you choose to go. We'll certainly address it when we find out, and, you know, when the time comes, and, right, and deal with that accordingly as it relates to a COLA, or at least a discussion point, which you may have alluded to your thoughts or feelings on that. And we'll cross those bridges as we get there.
Sure. Yeah, and so the makeup of the board will be slightly different, yeah, then.
So,
well, I think the idea behind meet and confer, mm-hmm, was that we were trying to get to a 2-year process. We were trying to make, yeah, an adjustment, and obviously we can't bind a future board's decision, but our thoughts, yeah, were that there's no COLA this year, we're going to make a salary adjustment. We'll see what next year brings, but that would be that was kind of our thinking. But again, we can't make that decision now for next year.
Correct. I'd prefer we cross that bridge, and then we can have talking points as you decide appropriate at the time, mm-hmm, depending on what it is and where it goes, and deal with that as the one open item, if you will.
Thank you.
Any other comments or discussion?
Nope.
I will say, I think you did an excellent job with the budget this year, given the constraints that we had and some of the surprises that you got. We never expect some of the things that we got. The health insurance was a welcome surprise, for sure. As you've noted in your communication, operating expenses are continuing to go down, though wages and benefits continue to rise. But that's not unique to our organization. That's a cost of doing business. I'll go back to what you said, one of the first budget presentations you ever did with us, which was that your goal was to steady out the line, so to speak, because we had budgets that were hills and valleys. And your goal was a 3-4% increase every year, which was going along with inflation, cost of doing business, cost of goods. Some go up, some go down. But overall, things get more expensive. I can't tell you that living in my house or running my life has gotten cheaper every year. It hasn't. And this year, we're looking at a 4.7% increase. I don't think that's out of line with what we're accomplishing. We're hiring 3 new full-time staff, as well as the other staff you talked about. We're making salary adjustments. We're doing some pretty amazing things while reducing operating expenses. So overall, I'm very happy with the budget where it is, and I think you guys have done a great job.
Thank you.
Chief, I would be remiss if I didn't mention a big thank you to you and your staff for doing all the hard work on this. I mean, this is my first budget process, and it was kind of pain-free for me, but I know you guys worked your tails off behind the scenes to bring all this documentation forward, and I thank you for that. And to see the numbers come in what they were, and you had truly price reductions on items through negotiation versus deferring items to another budget year. So this is a true savings, and I, for one, appreciate it. So thank you.
Thank you. And I would be remiss without, you know, obviously given the finance group, Sandy and Pam, basically kind of make sure all this stuff happens in the background or in the foreground, wherever you look at that. Having Jeff come on board midstream, having Ed come on board, Suizo retire, all those parts and pieces, you know, all kind of happen all at the same time. It's a great team to put together. It's a long, arduous process, as you mentioned. In January we start or so, and I'm looking forward to finding whatever opportunities are to shorten that up. But you just have to, in the transparency part of our job is, you know, there's just procedures and processes that need to take place. There's things that I would like to do, but it's you that makes the final decision on the board, not me. So we have to have these meetings and over this prolonged period of time to meet the statutory requirements, to meet the transparency we want to have with our constituents out there in TV land. So I do appreciate the kind words, and it's really for a whole bunch of folks that make that happen. So thank you to staff.
All right, so if there's no more comment, we would look for a motion to approve as proposed.
I move to approve publishing the proposed FY 2017 budget and the projected FY 2018 budget as required by law, with a public hearing scheduled for June 15th, 2016.
I'll second it.
Okay, is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, Chief, don't blink, because we'll be starting again before you know it.
Yeah.
January will be here sooner than you think.
Yes.
All right, we'll look to publish next month.
Approve next month.
Approve next month and publish. All right, so we're moving on to consent agenda for April 20th, 2016, regular and executive sessions. I move to approve as submitted. Is there a second?
A second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, public forum.
No one has wished to speak, sir.
All right, approval of the financial report. Everybody got that in their board packet.
Mm-hmm.
Sandy, we'll talk about your plans in a minute, but do you have anything else to add right now as we come to the end of the fiscal year here? Discussion or a motion to approve?
I move to approve the financial report for April of 2016.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Chief, we're on to the staff report.
Okay. Board, as promised last month, I will not go line by line on this report unless you have questions specifically, but I do want to highlight a couple things, so I will go a few lines, not all of them. 392 calls for the month, so a fairly busy month. You can look at the last 2 months. Makes sense, time of the year, lots of folks around, things like that, so we continue to be busy and lots of stuff going on there. May have a little bit to do again with the response times, looking at the traffic and things like that. It's a little bit up, and
yeah.
Traffic's been traffic. So, so lots going on there. Anyway, so that's that piece. There are two significant events. One, we had a wildfire in the village on a Saturday afternoon, April 23rd, that caught a house on fire and did about $175,000 worth of damage. There were some juveniles that were determined to be the cause of the fire, and Yavapai County Sheriff was taking care of that component of the matter. But crews did an amazing job. I'll just dovetail this part of my report. Talks about P.J. Lingley, Captain P.J. Lingley. So the reason we were able to swear in Captain Wells today is Captain P.J. Lingley, who's been a almost 16-year member of our organization, has decided that he will no longer be a captain here at Sedona Fire District, and he'll go to the Bear Jaw crew up in Highlands Fire and be more of a wildland firefighter kind of guy, which he's true and true. Probably that's his passion. It's always been his passion. He's got the mustache to prove it. And so we're very sad when it's been a couple of years he's been kind of tinkering with the idea. They've been kind of courting him to consider this option. And so for whatever reason, he decided this was a good year to do it. And so we certainly appreciate P.J. Lingley, Captain Lingley, for all he's done for our organization and the passion he has for wildland. We had lunch with him yesterday as his last day was also this morning at 7:30. He finished up. He starts on Monday up in Bear Jaw. And it's like, I think the fire station now is three doors from his house, so he's got a long commute to work. He's pretty excited about it, and we're excited that he's where it wants to be. So that's kind of neat. But he was first in on this fire here, and the actions of his crew with a very dynamic scene going on, his experience in wildland, his crew's experience in wildland, were able to get a hold of this fire, and it was threatening an apartment complex. A short while later, responding crews, I believe from Station 6, got there, and they saw smoke coming from one of the structure. Embers had landed on the roof, and there was vegetation debris on the roof that ignited and caused the fire to start up there and burn down through some venting that was on the roof. So quick actions, great training, incredible experience through our wildland program and things that we do in wildland all contributed to an what really is an excellent outcome for what a very dynamic fire was. It started off in a very, very hostile type way, if you will, and we took a very aggressive approach to get ahead of it and make the outcome what it was. And so sad that we lost a house, or we didn't lose the house completely, but it was uninhabitable. And so I wanted to say thanks to Captain PJ Lingley and the folks on C Shift Station Number 3 for their quick actions at that fire. And then B Shift was here with Battalion Chief Cochran's crew. They responded to a fire at a restaurant in Hillside, and his crew got there, did a great job putting out a fire that was on an exterior wall, or between a wall, kitchen and the exterior wall, but they did a great job about 11 o'clock at night. No, or 9:15 at night. Gosh, it felt later than that, Dave, didn't it? By the time we were done, it was after 11. But crews did a great job there. And again, a commercial assignment where we were in a commercial environment becomes a bunch of challenges, and that Hillside project is a very unique layout and presents a whole lot of challenges. And the guys did a great job on that fire and keeping that to what it was. I will say, if that had been 2 hours later when they closed up and went away and that would have started, we would have heard about it about 3 a.m. when somebody driving by saw the show, and it would have been a different outcome for sure. So, great job.
Chief, I just think it's important. That restaurant opened for business the next day as if nothing happened. So I think that just gives you a little bit of idea of what the crews were able to make happen for.
They served smoked salmon.
They what?
Smoked salmon.
I'm sorry. The
last thing I'm going to say here on the ba-dum boom on that one, on your grant update, we about $1,885 from the Ponderosa Fire Council, or the PFAC Advisory Council, for some wildland fire training. So again, we talk about where we're looking for opportunities, and you know, it's $1,800, but it's $1,800, and we're looking at those options. And then Division Chief Mazulis had an opportunity to go to a meeting called NAMES, Northern Arizona Emergency Medical Services, and talk about some stuff they were doing with some education reimbursement, and through his attending those meetings and realizing there was an opportunity, we were able to capture a $1,600 grant to help offset some of the costs we've spent in EMS continuing education. So, you know, back to the budget, back to all the stuff we're doing, that's $3,400, but it's $3,400 that's not, you know, being that we recouped. And when we talk about alternate funding and some of the things, alternate revenue sources, mm-hmm. you know, we're shaking the trees, we're looking at, and if it's $1,600 or $1,800 at a crack, we'll be more than glad to have that opportunity. So thank you to Division Chief Mazulis and would be, I guess, Battalion Chief Coyle and Training Officer Duran that put together the PFAC grant language as well. So, and then Pam, who coordinates all that. So any questions as it relates to the actual Fire Chief report other than what I spoke to? I will continue with my report then, if I see all nods, smiles. Okay, a couple things I want to talk about during my chief's report here. The website redevelopment update, we just continue to look at that. It's on the radar, and I don't know, Jeff, have you got any updates specific to it? We're trying to get done, but we've done a few things. Like
Jeremy was just talking to us, but he said, didn't he say a couple weeks where he's going live?
Did he?
Could be.
Yeah, he was just talking to us about the updates.
We got to be getting close. I mean, so you look in the room today, you see the new camera in the back, you see the TV behind me. The new podium over there, you know, this last week or two has been spent working with some folks to actually upgrade the system here, new microphones. So now we'll be able to do a board presentation. You'll be able to sit there, presentation behind you, and then you'll be able to look at the TV and watch the watch the PowerPoint on the TV there without having to swing around and do all that stuff. So continuing to make those improvements and doing those things that needed to be upgraded. The quality of the camera, I can't wait to see what it looks like. It should be way better than it was. And the functionality and all that stuff. So kudos to Jeremy Harris for doing all that work and getting our IT stuff squared away, and just prioritization stuff that we've been working on. Cottonwood Public Safety Center update. Jeff, you got anything you want to add on that?
We're working with the communications center there on our new protocols we just put in place with moving some vehicles around And Chief Lukowski and I are also going to be working with them on performance standards for managing and handling calls for our district, which hopefully will trickle down to the other agencies that are a part of the system. They have their national standard for dispatchers and handling mostly the police, law enforcement side of the business. They've been handling Cottonwood and Clarkdale for a while, but never really performance-based approach. So we're going to start introducing those measures and see what we can do to start tracking and help them for quality improvement. So that's in process.
Sorry, I'm eating a cookie. They're good. Continued work in that arena. So thank you, Jeff, for picking up that and continue to carry on our high level of expectation. And we're making, we're chipping away at it. We're getting there. Remind everyone that the FireWise cleanup program, May 20th to the 22nd at station number 4. We encourage all our folks to consider being, you know, defensible space and FireWise ready. So there's flyers here. I just want to make sure folks get out there and get their places cleaned up, and we provide that service. You might find it hard to believe, but I do have a trophy to show you that I was, again, the reigning champ of a chili cook-off. I'll just show this for all to see. Nice work.
Yeah. So you have to defend it again?
I don't know. We'll see if they invite me back or I get a challenger. The Sedona Rotary did a great job. It had a great turnout. Had the weather just great for chili. It was a great chili weather, I would say, right, Tim?
It was great weather.
It was great weather. My competition did a great job. Chief Terry Keller did an outstanding job. His chili was hot. Had a nice, long, hot burn going. So I think some of the folks might not have endured the heat in which he brought. Others may have loved it. Tim may know the full voting and how close it was, but we won't push him on that. But it was a great time, another great experience for the fire district to have some exposure out there in the community. Lots of great feedback. I was lucky enough to have Jody Fowler and Trisha. Jody's our front desk admin. Her and Trisha helped me cook, which was awesome. We had a fun time. And then Jody and her daughter Elizabeth and my daughter Cammie were there to serve all day, and we had a great time at the event. So thank you to all of those folks that helped us, and glad to proudly support a fancy. I will say to the Rotary Club, nice job. You upgraded from that medal last year to this thing, and I really appreciate it. I don't know where it's going to go, but I'll find a place. So thank you for that.
You deserved it.
Oh, I deserved it. I don't know about that, but the tribe has spoken, I guess. Just want to update you on a thing we're working on right now, workers' compensation pool. We are in the process of working with a group, Ashton Tiffany, which is a organization. I'm not sure what I would, Tim, you might know what Ashton Tiffany, they do the APEP, they help facilitate
they also,
APEP.
They're an advisor to the medical group right. The city's part of.
Right.
They're like a third-party administrator?
Right.
Yeah, exactly. And they're lawyers, I don't know if they're insurance folks, they're not brokers.
They're like third-party administrator, they administer plans, but they're not the actual insurers. So yeah,
cool,
they
yes,
are like,
correct.
Yeah. Kind of lawyers probably, I guess.
So we're in the process of evaluating. You know, we're currently in a system where we have one provider. We used to have SCF, State Compensation Fund, which was a state-run fund, a government-subsidized or run operation. Years ago, they stopped that. They created this new company called Copper Point, and Copper Point was operating in a way that they were the vendor and the broker. And that didn't really work really well, conflicting needs for a for-profit business. So the folks were forced to break that up and give it to 4 vendors to sell CopperPoint's product. So we're working with a great group called Menard Ames. We had a great meeting today talking about the what we currently have in our workers' comp and how it's calculated and all that great stuff. But a group of fire chiefs who are also a little tired of some of the stuff that's happened in the past. Began to look at an opportunity to create a pool. And it's not a high-risk pool, it's just a pool. And very common, there's this Ashton Tiffany works, there's actually a school district workers' comp pool with, I think, 238 school districts across the the state. I don't know how many there are. It's got to be close to all of them, it sounds like.
About 240.
Yeah, so almost all of them. There you go. They already run a pool. So we're following a tried and true methodology. And so we're looking at this as being an option. We met a month ago or so. We talked a few months before that, and we thought that we'd be talking about fiscal. And we met with them, and they said, listen, we have a short window. We could actually make this happen in fiscal 17, but this has to happen, this has to happen, this has to happen. And we're on that path. And so we had a long conference call today. There's a few more things that have to happen, but if all the stars do align, we are interested in moving to this pool option for our workers' comp. We would be coming forth to you at the next board meeting with hot off the press stuff. I think we're talking about something was on June 13th. We had to have something that happened by June 13th. Our meeting's on the 15th, so I may not have in your packets all the data, but it would be at this point, it would be a kind of a zero cost, neutral cost from what we've budgeted, basically. I got to get the final numbers, but we're expecting to be a net zero impact to the budget to get into this pool. It's really a long-term sustainability that will keep our costs much more neutral. Where you remember 2 years ago, we came to you with this $75,000 request for this increase that we didn't know about and things like that. Those things wouldn't happen. So we're quite excited about the opportunity. I'm not sure if it will happen because there's just a lot of moving parts, and there's 12 or 13 or 15 fire districts that'll all have to get their boards on board and all that stuff. But I guess I open it to any head nodding or any comments that might be of concern as if I'm going in the wrong direction. I know Tim would have some experience in the pool process as it relates to APEP and other things in your past life. There is a long-term sustainability and viability to leveling things out and having some predictable things. And I don't know if you have any comments to that.
Well, I know that the pool that the city participates in has worked out really very well and has brought some predictability to future rate increases. And so it's worked out very well from my knowledge.
Excellent. That's what I was looking for. Thank you. Anyone else have any comments, concerns, or questions, just so I know if we're heading down the right road?
Well, you'd mentioned that Copper Point, I don't want to say they misclassify our people, but they don't really...
Well, no, I misinterpreted that or misrepresented. They have two codes.
They tend to say you're a firefighter, you're not a firefighter. And we have mechanics, and we have admin staff, and we have...
Well, the admin staff get their own code. There's two codes we're allowed in the fire department. And NCCI, I believe it is... makes it all happen. The example they gave this morning was in the airline industry, a flight attendant is actually categorized as an outside salesperson. Why that is, I don't know, but however they figured it out, that's how the airline industry gets a flight attendant. They're just classified not as a flight attendant, but as an outside sales. For us, NCCI has said, hey, fire departments, you get fire department code 7710 and you get 8810, which is clerical. Those are two codes you get. Whatever you do, they got to fit in one of those two things. And if you don't really aren't really clerical, you're going in this code. And there's weighted cost to each of those codes. So a firefighter is like $5.71 is the multiplier, the rate, whatever you want to call it. The clerical is like 0.23 or something like that. So you can see some differences there. Anyway, long and short is there's a lot of fire chiefs that are upset with this classification of these coding pieces and some of the things that have happened in the past. There's actually a new company called 7710, ironically, for the code that firefighters are classified in, that is trying to write workers' comp coverage here in the state. There's a few fire districts that have gone to them for various reasons, but they're working through a third party. They don't have a license in Arizona. There's some things that need to get lined up. So we didn't jump in on that last year when they did quote us. We weren't comfortable with being the first one out of the gate. Now that this option is in front of us, this is probably a much more viable option for us to consider. So our intent will be to come back to you next month if all the stars align with a need to sign a contract or whatever other documents we would have to engage in that process. Again, if it all happens, but I on the conference call today, there were a bunch of folks that were really worried about how their board would take it and what they would be looking at and information. And I think you as a whole have been very trustworthy of staff that were, you know, keeping us on the above the line and doing things that make sense. And so this, to me, makes sense if it all lines up. So we're looking at that to continue to, again, be best practice and have that predictability in our budget, help with that, you know, 4% increase type target.
Chief, you said that the actual contract would not be available soon enough to be in our packet materials?
I don't know that for sure. We have a meeting that's scheduled, I think, for the 6th of June right now, a phone conference, with hoping we get all the parts and pieces to have that conference call. There was something in the PowerPoint that had June 13th, and I don't remember what that was, but there was something on June 13th. Our board meeting happens to be the earliest it possibly can be with the being the 15th, so we just end up in a spot. And if we have to have a special board meeting or something, we'd look, but we're looking to start July 1. Actually, you have to start July 1. There's not a an opportunity to go August or September. You pay a penalty to Copper Point at that point. So we're cautiously optimistic that we can put this together and it'll be good. But I just want to make sure I had a good flavor for where the board was at and what you think, that wasn't in the wrong venue.
Is there a way that, let's say you get this document on the 13th, that you could still forward that
to
board members
before
the meeting?
Oh, I certainly will. As soon as we get it, we'll get it to you for certain. And we may be able to get the draft document, the actual contract they're going to do, just whether or not it comes to fruition might be another story, too. We could have it maybe tomorrow if they have something drafted already. But the blanks or the numbers may not, the actuarials and things like that. We're just moving, not at light speed, but just a click under on that.
I think my only worry is that there's enough departments that get into the pool.
Correct.
That the risk adjustment is adverse. So if it's three departments, I don't think we're interested.
No.
If it's 13 or 15.
Correct.
We could be.
Yeah, the Ashton Tifton is very clear about they have to have a certain number, the mass, there's a name for it, not mass, well, it was mass, but collective mass, or the, anyway, the aggregate. There's enough people in there to make it viable for the group, not just for anybody, but for the group to be, you know, successful.
And Chief, if I could just add that Ashton Tiffany, I was on the Board of Trustees for our insurance group, and Ashton Tiffany was really very professional in their approach as to how they administered the plan, and I have nothing but good things to say about them.
I think we're in good hands, so thank you. I agree. No action needed, just smiles or...
Well, I just want to say thank you for pursuing, you know, a possibility that looks quite good and will give us more predictability. So thank you for that. If you know, there are 5 Wednesdays next month, so if it's too tight, you know, we could consider, given if it works for everybody, moving our board meeting back a week.
Well, I think short of that, the last motion we just made was to make a public budget meeting on the 15th of June, so we have to change that or something if we want to do that or have a special meeting. But I think we'll be okay. We may just end up having to have a special meeting. If it, for some reason it ends up being tight, I'd rather just worry about having to have a special meeting for this one issue. If that's what does happen, I think is more of a safe bet than worrying about pushing it back right now, if that's okay. A couple things. Yesterday, Division Chief Mazulis and myself attended a meeting at the synagogue, and it was put on by the, was that NAMI?
Mental Health Coalition of Green Valley.
Yeah, Northern Arizona Mental, no.
They just call themselves Mental Health Coalition.
Okay, the Mental Health Coalition. Oh, yeah, right here. Mental Health Coalition, Verde Valley, right there, it says it. And we sat in on a very nice presentation. And I say nice, it was a very tough topic on suicide as it relates to, you know, both the recent bridge incidents as well as the car crash that occurred on Cooks Hill a while back ago. I guess about a year ago now, I think it was. And I think it was B-Shift that had that one as well. Chief Mazulis sat on the panel and did a nice job just talking about how the first responders are involved and affected by some of the suicide pieces of the puzzle. The crew came over from Station 6 and accepted an award from the group just for our dedication towards mental health and as first responders. So we have a nice plaque here. And I just want to let you know the kind of stuff we're doing in the community. And I think it was a well-attended meeting. There's 30 or so people there. A nice message, hard message to listen to, but the net was that we're working hard to help the mental health component that our community's faced with, and then the first responders, how we interface with that as well. So very proud of that. And on to dovetail right into that, on Friday night at 9 o'clock, we'll be pulling apparatus out on the apron, turning our lights on as a remembrance for firefighters who have committed suicide. There's a high prevalence for that in our business. We've got a group, a gentleman who actually comes out of Illinois. I didn't know him in Illinois, but has retired from there and now actually lives in Anthem. And he runs a company or a business or a group called Firefighter Behavioral Health Alliance, a nonprofit that is hosting their first annual survivors retreat, or I'm not sure what it's exactly called, but they're down in the Phoenix Scottsdale area for a couple days. On Saturday, they'll be coming up here. They got a sponsor to provide Jeep rides for the group. And I asked, he said, well, we'd love to stop by your station. I said, well, what are you doing for lunch? And he said, well, we're not sure yet. I said, why don't we host you for lunch as a way to say thank you and honor those that have suffered the effects of suicide in our business. And he thought that was amazing. So I work with the charities. I think Chipotle is donating lunch for us, and we're going to host these folks from 11 to 1 on Saturday and just say thank you. Ironically, I believe one of the people that will be at the luncheon will be the father of a firefighter from Illinois that I worked with and actually left our job and committed suicide shortly after that. So just important part of our business that we don't talk about. And we want to be proactive in that. And I think, again, just shows our charities group willing to help step up. B-Shift is on duty. They said, absolutely. What do we need to do? And just a testament to Sedona Fire being, again, where we need to be. So. And the last thing I have, if it lets me go to it, if there's any thank you letters, I didn't look. I didn't look here. You see some pretty standard thank you letters that we get. It's just continue to do good things, and I think you said it today, Jeff, didn't you, about just the amount of thank you letters we get and just the kindness that people have for our service. It just says a lot about what we are and who we are, the dedication folks have on a daily basis. And I think these are fairly straightforward thank you cards, and you've got a chance to read them. I don't know if I need to outline them any more specific, but I think it says a lot there. So I don't have anything else on my chief's report.
All right. Comments or discussion? All right. We'll go on to poor old ambulance 511.
Money maker.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and board members. Ambulance 511, the old ambulance 511 that was just replaced by a new unit, right before it finished its last duty, it blew an engine, the motor itself. It leaked antifreeze into the block, which the diesels is a bad thing. It begins to erode elements of the system. So we pulled it out of service, had a reserve fill until the new ambulances were certified by DHS, and now we have a new unit filling the station requirements here. And as we sat back and tried to ponder what are we going to do with this unit, we started evaluating all of the new things that could be coming to us with the new budget and evaluating our fleet needs and still keeping in mind our right sizing of the fleet to make sure that everything that we do is based upon a measured result of how we're moving forward as an organization to serve community and keep that reliability of our fleet in play. So based upon the analysis, we looked at five options, and you have the options listed there. Option one is replace the motor and associated parts for $40,000. Option two was to refurbish the ambulance with a new chassis and updated patient compartment for $130,000. $166,000 and option three would be to replace the unit with a new unit using the new specification that you have the two vehicles that we just recently purchased. Option four was purchase a demonstration ambulance, and there were a few that we looked at, and we'd have to modify, thus the increased cost above building a new one, or just selling the unit and just doing away with it. After review, we talked with Fleet, we talked with our EMS folks, we talked with our operations managers, the battalion chiefs, and we came to the conclusion that we like option one. That's $40,000. The financial perspective is it's not a budgeted expense. We would be seeking board contingency authorization for that and utilizing a vendor that's on state contract.
And just to be clear, then, we replaced this ambulance, but it wasn't going out of service. It was supposed to remain as a reserve.
Correct.
For several more years. So, okay.
So the recommendation from staff and the fire chief is to request the board authorization to approve option one.
Well, and certainly we use reserve ambulances frequently. When was the next ambulance scheduled? We kind of discussed that in the meeting, but another capital
next
buy
year
was next, not for another year?
Well, the capital buy for another unit isn't in the schedule. It's refurb in fiscal 18, 19, and 20.
Would we refurb this unit if we're replacing a motor, or?
We will probably refurb, well, we'll see how things play out, but we would think that we would refurb this unit being the third in line in fiscal 20.
Oh, because we're refurb. My bad. When you refurb, the motor's gone, the whole chassis's gone. You're keeping the box.
Keep the box. Okay. So we may get this unit repaired or, you know, fixed, and we may say, listen, this thing's running great. We need to push this refurb. Let's push it down 2 years. Let's flip-flop something else around. We may make some other decisions secondary to where it goes, but right now the intent is move it, and then we may be able to sell the chassis with a brand new or 3-year-old motor in it, but, you know, for more money and recoup a little more money. So it's kind of that, I think it's a good solution, repairing it with the, because other options are to buy a new one, which is really expensive. Obviously, we just bought ambulances for $185,000. Refurbing it, which is going to cost about $120,000 or something like that, was it, Ed? Is that ish?
Roughly.
You know, $120,000, $130,000, which, again, we don't have that budgeted. So this is a good intermediate fix for us to do. We'd intend to get that, if you guys approve it, we'd get that out in contingency from this year's budget, and so we'd have it back here as, you know, as quick as it would take 5 or 6 weeks.
5 weeks.
5 weeks. Yeah, I guess it's got to be 5 weeks because we got to get it done before
July
1st.
Definition of contingency.
It would. It definitely meets the criteria for certain.
Okay. Any discussion or comments or questions?
Just makes a lot of sense. I like that you're choosing the least expensive option. Looks good.
Chief, is our own shops here doing any of this work, or is it all going to be farmed out, if you will, to the Sanderson commercial?
It'll be farmed out, yeah. I mean, there may be some work they do, but the gist of it is to get it there, and get the proposal is to get the new engine, new alternator. I mean, get it so it's new. Not taking
the old
8-year-old alternator on a brand new engine, and then the alternator goes out 4 days later. Yeah. You know, let's get this thing so it's going to run smooth.
Did I see it's 2-year unlimited mile warranty? Is that what I read?
On the motor itself, yes.
On the motor.
Yeah.
Any further discussion?
I'll go ahead and make the motion. I move to approve purchase order 10604 for $40,000 to Sanderson Ford for the replacement of the motor and associated components for ambulance 511.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Microsoft, Bill Gates.
And Bob. Good evening again. This is a standard a business line item for us to renew our enterprise support agreement with Microsoft for the cost of $19,440, and that's for the entire district.
Budgeted item, no surprises. Any discussion or questions? Okay, I'll move to approve PO 9980 to SHI for purchase of Microsoft Enterprise Agreement renewal in the amount of $19,440.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Chief, consent agenda issue?
Board, it just, you know, came to me that we have a lot of issues like the one we just voted on that are pretty standard run-of-the-mill budgeted items, things that aren't really super exciting. They just are the cost of doing business, so to speak. And it seemed to me that there might be some opportunities for us to just include some of these items in a consent agenda. And that's really up to your purview. I'm happy to make this meeting as long as possible because I could probably do that well. My thought was that there was an interest in routine type of things. You know, we're buying 10 sets of turnout gear. We buy 10 sets of turnout gear every year. There's nothing more to say about it. It's just it's budgeted. It's what we do. It's a replacement program. We would put that on the consent agenda. You again would approve consent agenda items 1 through 6 or whatever that may be. If one of you has an opportunity where you have a question, a concern, you're not sure about something, you can always say, I'd like to pull number 3. We pull number 3. We say this is a Microsoft Enterprise Support Agreement. This is, you know, and we explain what it is because you weren't sure or whatever it is. There'd be a board packet information so you'd still see about what it is ahead of time, but it would just save time. So pretty common practice in city government does it, and we may only have 1 or 2 items on there. We may not have any items, but sometimes we seem to have 2 or 3 or 4 things that we spend 40 minutes talking about that we could probably just approve on a consent agenda. If that was an interest that you have. We certainly want to balance the transparency and the opportunity to talk and discuss items and do that type of stuff, but it's the best practice, I think, out there, and it's fairly common. So we just wanted your opinion before we started doing something like that. If there was an interest or not, we're happy either way.
You know, I appreciate wanting to shorten the meeting. I think that's great. At the same time, for the public, I think it's helpful for them to know where the money's going and why. So I'm of two minds about this one. I look forward to hearing from my fellow board members about this.
Well, I think it's a good idea. I think it does help running a more efficient meeting. And the fact that if there are questions, you can pull an item off consent agenda and discuss it in more detail. Now, some organizations will actually establish a cap on the amount of money that can be approved on the consent agenda. Like they'll set a cap of items less than $50,000 or items less than $100,000. And anything that's above that limit, that cap that's set by the board, the governing board, has to go be on the regular agenda. So there's, I don't know, Chris, if you're talking about trying to develop a policy for consent agenda items or not, but I do know that it does lend itself to a little more efficiently run meeting when you have consent agendas.
So on this agenda, like today, I would have put this enterprise agreement on there. That's the only thing that would have been on there. You know, last month there might have been 2 or 3 items, if I remember. There was a little longer agenda last month. There might have been 2 or 3 things that were kind of rudimentary. Setting a cap, I'm leaning a little bit towards you guys as to what your flavor is, whether that's 25, whether it's 30, 40, $50,000. I certainly, you know, I think some numbers over that we should probably definitely be, you know, taking action on outside of that. But I'm open to any of those things. Most of our items are in that $15,000 to $25,000 range that are just licensing and turnout gear and things like that, you know. So,
well, I would be in favor of, I'd say a $50,000 cap is fine. I'm definitely in favor of this. I'll say I've done some teaching with Bill Whittington at the AFTA convention, and we talked about length of board meetings. He's not here to defend his statements, but I'll say that he had said most of these meetings should take 60 to 90 minutes unless there's something really significant on the agenda. We went almost 5 hours last month.
Don't remind me.
So anything that could streamline a meeting, you know, we are not the largest district in the state, but I would venture to say we have some of the longest meetings sometimes about some things that probably aren't necessary to drag out quite as much as we do. So I appreciate your streamlining the chief's report. I'm certainly not trying to say that we shouldn't talk about things that need to be talked about, but I agree, items that are already budgeted, that the decisions are already made, and we just have to approve the monies, we probably don't need to spend 10 minutes discussing it. Any board member will always have the opportunity to say, you know what, I know you have items 1 through 5 on the consent agenda today. I want to talk about all of them. everybody on the board has the right to say that, and we will pull them out and talk about them.
And that's the interesting part. So we approve a budget, which includes all these items, and then we come to you again to ask you to approve them again. I mean, really, I mean, in some ways, it's kind of interesting, but there's rules and policies.
I'd be okay with 50,000, but I'm open to discussion or thoughts on that.
So I'd just like to add that I like the idea of streamlining it with a consent agenda. And I think if there is any concern from the public, they're always welcome to attend. The agendas are always posted well in advance, so the opportunity is there if there is question from the public to come and partake and see us.
So I'm clear. Me, you would have expected this ambulance engine replacement to not be a consent agenda item.
Correct. It's not certainly not an expected.
Right. Well, it's not budget, so I guess in that case, it's a contingency item. But even if we were, I guess it was budget and we were going to do some mechanical work, I guess you could have included that. Mm-hmm. Being contingent, no. I just want to kind of get a flavor for what, and we'll test the waters. We'll see where you're at. We'll learn where the comfortability is. This should be a consent or this shouldn't, and we'll.
And Chief, there might be situations where if the board does set a financial cap, that even though an item might be under that financial cap, you may decide that this is too important or politically sensitive that you're going to put on the regular agenda anyway.
Correct. That's what I was trying to say. Thank you for that. What he said. God, I love you guys.
Any other thoughts, or are we okay with at least maybe we can trial that for a month or two and see, and if we, Corey or anyone mm-hmm. who says they want to go back to the old way, we can certainly discuss a change. And I think it's 50,000. This is not going to be a motion, right? This is just a consensus of how we're going to do business.
Yeah, I don't think we need a motion to change that. It's within our rights and ability, and we already have a consent agenda. And it's just what we're putting in it.
Is everybody comfortable with 50,000 and under being appropriate for consent agenda?
I am. Sure.
Mm-hmm. You can still say yes or no. You're not going.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's try that for a month or two and see if it streamlines things.
Excellent.
Then again, we may keep talking. Still may take 4.5 hours.
It's the time we love to spend with each other that's important. It's quality.
All right.
Is that Murphy's Law?
Probably. Back to my agenda. Okay, ASRS, sorry.
So, Board, as you recall, the previous motions you made were to consider or approve going to Arizona State Retirement System. So there's a previous approval of going to Arizona State Retirement System, and our intent was to go the last pay period in June. June 18th would have been our start date. Through just numerous conversations with Arizona State Retirement, one of them came up and said, oh, by the way, you know that you have to start on the first of a month. Well, that would have been nice because we've only had 10 discussions and 100 emails that talked about this. But anyway, so being that you approved a intent to go to June 18th, we have to go to June 1st based upon the premise that the board was looking at wanting to be in this fiscal year. So we're moving the ball forward, but we just need approval from you to actual motion to accept a June 1st start date for Arizona State Retirement System beginning June 1st, 2016 for eligible employees.
Makes a lot of sense.
Sure does.
We've discussed this on at least a couple other occasions.
Absolutely.
Yes.
It's just a technicality. Mm-hmm. I for me was more of a rounding error, so to speak. But Mr. Whittington advised that because you did make a motion in the past relative to a benefit that was supposed to start June 18th, mm-hmm. it's probably safer for us to get another motion clarifying that we will start on June 1st. Mm-hmm. Make everybody happy.
And we did this so that we can get some of the cost associated with it into this year's budget.
Correct.
Yeah. Well, I can go ahead and move to amend the previous motion entering ASRS for eligible employees from June 18th, 2016 to June 1st, 2016 and approve all related costs to coincide with that date as outlined.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Board.
All right. staffing update.
Okay, this is an update. I'll do this as quick as I can, but we got some stuff going on. And so as you are aware, Fire Marshal Johnson has decided to retire from Sedona Fire after a few years, like 38 or so. And with that opens a position for Fire Marshal. We closed those applications on Monday. We received nine applications for interest in that position. So we're beginning that process of going through the resumes and the questionnaire that we provided them. We will be inviting some folks out for an assessment center process. June 12th or something like that? I don't know, whatever that.
13, 14.
Monday, Tuesday in June. So we're getting that kind of put together for that position. We still have an open fire inspector position. We actually have had a couple testing opportunities there, and a few of the folks that have netted the top spot when we offered up the positions for whatever reasons have decided that they didn't want the job or whatever. At this point, we decided it's probably best to keep that spot open and let the new fire marshal have some say in the new fire inspector position. We have actually a person on light duty right now that's filling the role anyway, so it's kind of working out fine the way it's working. So we've got that piece going on. I mentioned about Captain PJ Lingley, who's retired after almost 16 years of service. We just got to witness Josh Wells filling that position. However, as his position moves up into the captain, we now have an open firefighter position. So that open firefighter position sits as of today. There's some talks about maybe another opening down the road to some other retirements that are in the process, which we'll just leave on the sideline, but we're considering there might be another opening in the near future. And then we're talking about three firefighters coming in October. So we're trying to find, do we hold an academy today, hold another academy in another 6 or 8 weeks, you know, if there's another opening possibly that happens, and then another academy in September. That doesn't seem real cost effective. So we're trying to, you know, right now we're gonna fill this with overtime, the first firefighter position, figure out what happens with the potential one, and then our academy. And we're gonna see how we're gonna do that. And we're still out to decision on this one as to how we're gonna do it. So we may end up hiring five firefighters if all those things come together at one time for that October date. Our goal is probably to start those firefighters in October, so we're probably gonna bring them in a little bit earlier. If we're bringing those folks in a little bit earlier, it's kind of crazy, but we almost got to start almost now, close to, because by the time we get them through all the hurdles, make notifications to their employers, all that stuff, it's, we're almost right there. So we're hashing that out, but it's probably gonna be four or five at one time with that. So then that's exciting too, to have an academy with that many people. So some economies of scale there.
Chief, in respect to that item, you'll be pulling from a list that's already been created through
Correct.
Past testing?
That's the intent, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Chief, one more question on that. They're scheduled to start in October. Would they go into the academy prior to that date, or would that be the day that they go into the academy?
I think we're probably gonna start them early, so they start staffing on that October 1st timeframe. You know, and so that's, yeah, there's some cost of doing business, but if we bring them in October, by the time we get them done, we're almost in November by the time we really launch them after 2 weeks of the academy and then finding the right shift for them to go. We're certainly midway through October, and I think we're ready to start them as soon as we can. So that's what we'll be doing. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Human Resource Manager, we're excited that offer has been made to a new HR person. Her name is Betty Johnson. She's accepted the position. She's got a few more pieces to go through, but I don't think there'll be a problem. She'll be moving here effective a week and a half or so, and we're expecting her to start June 6th is the date, 6-7, depending on how things play out. Got an MBA. She's got a very, very impressive resume. We're excited for what she can bring to our organization. And currently she holds the title of Chief People Officer, which I think is just cool. I share that every time I talk to folks. That is just kind of neat. And so she works for a progressive company that just is taking a look at things and is working some good stuff in the HR world. And so I think she'll be a high improvement, bringing high expectations to our organization. So excited for that. We're managing right now. Keona's working double times trying to make everything happen, so we appreciate Keona picking up the slack in the meantime, and all, everyone else that's picked up, Sandy and a few others that have made things happen, but much needed. And then lastly, very sad to announce officially that Sandy has announced her retirement as well. On August 14th, she will have completed 3 decades of work here at Sedona Fire, her 30th year, 30th anniversary on August 14th, and so she'll be moving on. Sad stuff, but the organization does appreciate everything she's done for us and brought us to where we are today. We're still as staff working on some options as to how we're going to progress and move forward in that position. We had a great meeting with staff in the finance division and about some of our options, and so we're looking at all those, and we're looking at an efficient model and one that makes sense for us, and we'll be coming forth with that probably at the next board meeting if we make a final decision as to which way we want to go with that. And I will leave it at that unless there's any specific questions.
Congratulations, Sandy. I think 30 years is enough. That's okay. Well, are you going to do something exciting for retirement?
Enjoy it.
Okay.
So staff is committed to continue to find all the options for the best candidates for our stuff, and some of the things we talked about earlier as it relates to salary and all those pieces and parts that go into that, a package that attracts high caliber candidates. It's all part of our master plan, if you will, to continue to attract those, provide, you know, the best of the best for our positions. Our organization deserves it, our community deserves it, and doing some of the things we've done help facilitate that and make that happen. So I thank you for your previous motions on budgets and things like that, and it all dovetails into this piece here. So I think we'll be in good shape, net. But we do appreciate both Gary and Sandy with 68 years of experience between the two of them in this organization. It's just huge, and we'll have some other words to say as it gets, you know, closer till. But we certainly do appreciate and love all you've done for Sedona Fire.
Shared Services Committee. Did you guys meet?
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's you.
I apologize for
Mr. Ernst.
I was reading a novel here. No, but I apologize. We actually have a meeting scheduled for Monday at 9 a.m. Down in Cottonwood.
Correct.
So this will be the first meeting that we've had in probably, what, about 2.5 months?
Oh, at least, yeah. Maybe 3 or 4 even, actually. Yes. Time flies when you're having fun.
So, board member Soto, Mr. Soto, is going to be appointed to the Shared Services Committee, and I believe the city manager of Cottonwood
will
also be appointed at that meeting. Then there's a couple other items on the agenda. So that'll be our first meeting in quite a while.
Yeah, one of our thoughts are, as an organization, and Jeff, jump in if you will, our purpose and mission is to try to find all the opportunities. You know, I look at the workers' comp pool. That's really a shared service. You know, we're looking at combining our efforts and getting a better product and some predictability pieces. We're looking at, you know, a couple different things for us to be more efficient, more ready, whatever it is, fiscally responsible, all these parts and pieces. Lots of stuff going on already. We've got, you know, this consolidation that happened down in, you know, Camp Verde or Clarkdale and Verde Valley. So that's been taking a lot of work and time and energy. There's a JPA process kind of going on in Camp Verde, Montezuma, Rimrock. No, they didn't.
Yeah.
Copper Canyon. Really?
Yeah.
That's cool.
So it's going to be a merger, or it's going to be
JPA, but they just announced the name change.
Wow.
So that'll be Camp Verde and Montezuma.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be called Copper Canyon.
Copper Canyon, and if you don't know, which I'm sure the canyon, you come down into the Ruby Valley from Phoenix, that's Copper Canyon.
Okay.
So, well, it's just been a lot of stuff happening. So the horsepower behind some of all these ideas has really been all for the mission of what we're trying to do in shared services, but it's happening in different parts and pieces. But I think there's a lot of great stuff happening, and Jeff jumped in, and he's got a couple projects he's trying to help facilitate a little bit, and we're working on getting an RFP out and stuff. So we want to get the board members on up to speed what we're doing and really trying to just see where that board really wants to take the organization. Do they want to continue to meet and have all this stuff, or they want to kind of just give it back to us with a directive, hey, you guys go forth, get a bunch of stuff done, and we'll see you a couple times a year if we need to or when we need to, and not feel like we've got the standing committee in the wings waiting, but more tap them when we need them. That makes sense, Jeff?
Yes.
He smiles a lot, nods all the time. I love this guy.
All right. Committee. Here comes Mr. Chablo. Fundraising is going well. I saw the check.
That's just one. I'll let the chief start. I'll be here if there's any question about fundraising, because we're a great integral team now. So,
thank you. I would probably turn over the fundraising piece to Mr. Soto. He's got a couple things on the agenda for the fundraising events. Jeff and I attended the committee meeting the other day. I think we made some real good progress as it relates to the next item on the agenda, which is really our focus and mission or purpose. So I will defer any other comments until we get to item number 2 and leave it to Mr. Soto if he's got any other comments as it relates to the committee or the fundraising events.
Well, Scott, I'm not really sure what you're going to present.
If you have questions, I have the updated totals. If you don't have,
okay,
I'll present them. And just some of the key people who have just donated, you can give the future events that we have,
sure,
that we have coming up.
Sure.
So
well, as of this past weekend, that was our latest event. We were over at Weber's with a market in the village, and we had a static display all day long with Scott and Wendy there. And pardon me?
Can't forget Wendy.
Nope, Scott and Wendy were both there. And the owner of Weber's,
Jake,
he not only allowed us to put the trailer with the girder there, but he also had a car wash, he had food, he had just, like, he opened up his whole parking lot for our cause. And with everything said and done, Scott, what sort of numbers did we reel in?
I'm waiting to get that here.
1264.
Here, let me find it here. I had it, and because it's on the...
And while he's looking for that,
okay,
the up and...
Okay, right, yeah, I got it right here.
You got it? Okay.
1246 from his concession stand. We raise in cash $657. Okay, and just so that you know, as Dave said, they had the car wash. The first time ever, the kids for the school down there, the Big Park School, raised over $2,000 for a car wash.
Wow.
All tied in together, we all did really, really well. So, it was a great event. It was a lot of fun. We're going to be doing it again in Uptown. I'll tell you about that in a minute.
So the car wash was for
the kids.
Their cause?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. And so we grossed out about $1,800 from that event. Mm-hmm. That's just that one day. Up-and-coming events on the 9th of June over at Vino de Sedona. We have our wine tasting event scheduled. That's from 4 to 7. Everyone here was welcome, invited, and it basically is for $35. You get 8 wine tastes, from which there will be wines and cheeses and food.
Does that include the stretcher to carry you out?
Well, keep in mind the tastes are just a little bit. They're not a full glass. But there will also be an art auction there. And you know, at $35 per person, we're looking to have at least 100 people there. And so just from those kind of numbers, you can see what our goal is for that event. Following that event, In July, we'll have the dinner that was postponed from an earlier date. Was going to be rescheduled to the 15th, but I come to find out that's our conference that we'll be down in Phoenix for, so it may go to the following weekend, which is the 22nd, but that's not set in concrete yet. But and then also on the Uptown, we'll have the trailer on the static display on the 28th.
Correct, 28th of May in Uptown in front of Canyon Breeze. I've gotten permission from Al Spector to do that. I'm going Tuesday with staff from the city to get approval to do an outdoor display and get a permit from them. And myself, maybe Wendy, Dave, and anyone else who wants to care to join us, I'll be up there all day. It really is, you know, it helps with the people. They see it, they touch it, and they give us cash. So
more
educating, and it brings awareness to the event.
So those are the three events that are up and coming, and those may very well be the three events that'll take us over the top there for what we're shooting for. To date, would you like me to give those numbers to date, or you got those?
Well, I have.
You got them?
I don't know if it was.
Go ahead.
Mine are right up to the second here.
Okay.
Ty, you mentioned we just received a great check today. Our largest check to date is $5,000. That came from the Gary Sinise Foundation. I don't know if I spoke about it the last meeting, but the Gary Sinise Foundation is Gary Sinise, the TV actor. He's Forrest Gump, he's Lieutenant Dan. And he's also on CSI New York. And he is the modern day Bob Hope. He has gone on his own dime around the world for our military, entertaining the military with the Lieutenant Dan Band. And he's very conscientious and a big help to Vietnam veterans, all war heroes, and 9/11 projects. So he has donated, or his foundation has donated $5,000. That included our gross receipts before expenses. So far, we have raised $46,946. Not too shabby. So pretty proud about that. We have other committed donations, people, organizations who have committed. We have another $4,746 coming in, and there's still others who have committed but with no dollar amount. So we're doing pretty good. I think Dave's three events, or his two events, and my static event, I think we're going to do well. So,
what are your expenses so far?
Our expenses right now are $8,982.28, and that includes the LEA. That's $8,600, and then we have an ad in the Red Rock News that was $303. We took two ads; they gave one for free. That was for the PJ's Pub, and then we had some minor incidentals for Staples and what have you. So, but it comes to $898.82.
So your available funds for construction would be
$37,967. That's in the bank. Get that, Ron?
37 what?
37,964. Okay. I want to make sure I get the right number in the paper.
All right, that's fantastic. Congratulations. You're moving right along. So that brings us to, are we okay? You okay if we move on to
please,
item two here?
You
so
bet.
Let's talk about the bids. We did receive three bids for the project. Mm-hmm. Chief, I don't have the numbers in front of me. Do you remember?
There's.
Okay. So we had three bids come back. We had initially hoped to be in the range of $50,000 for the project. The lowest bid came back at $65,600. The other two bids were significantly more. We had another one at $139,000 or $169,000. We have talked to. Actually, I say we. That's the royal we.
LEA.
We talked to LEA about potentially any changes that could be made to try and what they call value engineer to bring the cost down. However, essentially, we've kind of decided, and we have to talk it through. But there's not much value in reducing what's been. We went to the expense and desire to design something that we wanted from LEA that would work with the building that would do proper honor to the piece that would be something that this community would really stand behind, and to nickel and dime it at the last minute, I don't think makes any sense. So for us to go back and say, oh, let's take out this bench, or oh, let's take a, personally, I don't think that's a worthwhile thing to do. We have also, or the chief has also talked to the two bidders who were higher in this process to make sure that if we were going to change the parameters of the bid, would they be interested in rebidding? And they were not. They were so significantly out of contention with the one bidder who was low, they are not interested in discussing resubmitting the bids.
If just to highlight that, the three bids, one was $169,000, one was $139,000, and the low bid was $65,611.
All right. So, and you've talked to, it's DTAR, you've talked to them since then?
Yes.
With the, where are we right now with them?
So board, we're, as staff has looked at this, and the committee looked at this at a meeting, the interest, as you spoke to about wanting to not nickel and dime a few things, and I want to take away from the things that we designed in here, there's a this $65,611 option. We have a few things that we could deduct from that that have some importance to lower the number and not reduce the aesthetics of the project. One of them would be to consider removing the bond. And there was some discussion about this at a board meeting, but that's $1,911 for a $65,000 project. It's a local contractor who's really committed to this project at a no cost concept. He's not going to want to, you know, he wants to finish this project and get it done. It's really doing it for the project itself. I feel very confident in that as far as making sure we put as much money in the bricks and mortar as possible. There's a couple other pieces of that we looked at that would lower the cost to roughly about $62,000 and keep the rest of the project intact.
Yeah, Chief, was one of those, because I noticed one of the items possibly was instead of having polished cement, having unpolished. I certainly think the polish is a very
that's
good look.
Maintaining the polish.
Good. Okay,
that.
So that's
correct.
Not one of the.
No, that's not.
Okay.
Nope. There's lots of discussion about, you know, where do you want to take this and how do you make it look and the longevity of it and the upkeep and maintenance of it. And so spending the money in these areas and the things like that, that just makes sense. And they keep it's a polished look. The whole thing is polished to keep that same theme going.
But it also it helps with it not getting degraded over
correct.
Time. Besides it, it's beautiful.
Right. Mm-hmm. Correct. So... at the board meeting, at the committee meeting rather yesterday, there was discussion about, you know, there was a reduction of lighting package. And staff, when there was a committee member that expressed concern to try to find a solution to fix the value engineered lighting option. And so staff talked about it this morning and had a chance to sleep on it. We felt that taking away this lighting option really is going to detract from the entire project. And it would be our interest as staff to maintain that that feature. And as the group is focused on trying to get to their end fundraising piece, maintaining that certainly puts them that much further out. I think there would be a lighting option to reduce it, would have reduced the cost by like $7,000. But I think we're gonna see a reduction much greater than that in the overall project itself. And so staff is recommending that. And so with that, staff would recommend that the board consider, well, what we're faced with right now is we have a bid now. We went to RFP, we've got bids. The two are very high. The one that we're considering is the low bid. We need to consider awarding that bid so they can start the project so we can meet the deadlines that we've set forth. However, as just discussed, net, they're at $37,000. We're looking at a $62,000 project. In round numbers.
Well, and if you want to be clean, we should approve the bid as submitted, quite honestly.
Well, we do need to approve the bid at $65,000. We are paying, we at Sedona Fire is paying that bill. The committee's one of us. It's an extension of you. So we are needing to approve the bid for $65,000. And then I would like you to direct me to affect some change orders, kind of the things I spoke to, and allow me to finalize the details as we did with Station 6 and all that stuff, you know, it's
but without
reducing,
significantly changing the
correct
the concept of what we
correct
we and LEA
yep
intended.
And I'm telling you that I'm expecting that bill to be somewhere those reductions taking us only to about a $62,000 number, so it's just a some small
what would that consist of, the
removing
reductions?
The bid requirement.
Oh, okay.
There's a signage overage that they put in there as a surplus, just as kind of a catch-all, $500, just to move that out.
Mm-hmm.
There was a there's two other items, a testing. There was like a $1,500 testing and an inspection fee, which I believe there won't be any fees for the inspections from the city. So deducting those little things, which have nothing to do with the
sure.
aesthetics or anything to do with it, it's just a matter of getting the project completed and saving a few dollars in our pocket, if you will.
Okay, so by my rough math, if we take the bid as submitted, including the bond, which the bond's included at 65.
Correct.
So with what's raised to date, which we have 3 months plus, is that correct?
Yep.
6, 7, 8, yeah.
Yeah.
And we were looking for that not to exceed number last month, because we didn't want to write, especially if we'd gotten the check. If we had said, yeah, we'll back it, and it came back at $170,000,
yeah, right.
We would have
said, yeah, no problem.
So the not to exceed number that I get right now is 28,000. That's a shortfall. Mm-hmm. If you did no further fundraising today, we're short $28,000.
Right.
That's the math I came up with.
Worst case scenario, correct.
And that's approving the bid at $65,000 X dollars with what you've stated we have to date, plus or minus probably $500 to $1,000 with the change that was in there, but that's roughly where we're at. So I guess my recommendation is that we accept the bid that we put up for RFP. The board commits funds not to exceed $28,000 to complete the project, and we continue fundraising.
We could do that.
With the hope and expectation that we can get to a net zero, but we're not going to let I'm not going to let this project die at this point. We're
totally
we're raised over $40,000 and we're.
So is the schedule still to have this completed by September 11th?
Correct.
Dedicated,
yes,
on that date? And construction would commence when?
As soon as possible.
As soon as we get the contract. I talked to Joel Tatar today, and he said as soon as I get the contract, and Bill's already seen the AIA contract, and it's got the language and everything kind of moving. So we're pretty close to being able to do something tomorrow if I call him and say we're approved, green light.
Would the intent be to eventually raise all of the money necessary to pay the full cost of the?
It's up to the board.
Memorial.
My question is about the bond. That additional amount is something that the board wanted, as opposed to, out of my continuing to raise money. And of course, you will be paying it. But is it really still necessary to have that after what Chris had said about? The local contractor,
well,
his reputation.
Two separate issues. So,
yeah. In answer to your question, I think yes, our intent is to continue raising funds till every last penny is raised to pay for the project.
Fundraising. We're not green. In other words, we're not saying let's fund the project so that we're. Let's fund the project and quit fundraising. That's not what anybody's saying.
No, I understand
stuff
that.
Lined up. We're
but
not
we can still
anything.
Drop it down.
We could. So let's go to, so that I hope that answers that. But I agree. The second question is, how comfortable is everybody from a fiduciary standpoint of removing that 2,000 is a big percentage of a $60,000 job to pay for a surety bond, performance bond.
Do we have a legal opinion on that?
Yeah, there's not, well, it's, no, I just say no. I say no because I didn't ask him that, so I can't say no. I will tell you that we did not use a bond when we built the sign out front of the station, the civic sign and the wildland sign. We opted not to do that because of the cost of the bond, and it just didn't make sense. This is slightly different, but not too much different in my mind. And I was comfortable before our discussion. I think when you look at the legal opinion piece, just the answer probably is you're always safer. And especially based upon our legal counsel, you're always better, safer to have that. Larry Unger, who's been doing this 41 years, sent me an email saying he sees it to be very much unnecessary. He's had does not expect there to be any problem. Not that you ever probably do expect a problem, but I suppose in some cases you may have a vendor that's a low bid and you might really be concerned about it, and based upon our rules and expectations of low bid stuff, that you may really be really concerned about this. That's just not the case here with staff, based upon all the parameters. And I'm comfortable, I personally am comfortable with it not being in place. I think last time we had dialogue about it, and I'm not sure we knew the full scope and breadth of everything we were talking about. It was just kind of like, yeah, we of course you want to bond and do a couple of things. And I think now we have a rear view mirror look to go, I see what it looks like. I maybe we're okay. Mm-hmm. And so staff is definitely comfortable.
And Detar Construction has been in the community for some time and has a good track record.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Correct.
Other thoughts?
Well, I think I'm the one that may have brought up the issue when this was discussed before, and my concern is, I guess, having experienced a situation where we did not have that bond on a project, and it happened to be a local contractor, and it didn't work out, and it created a huge issue. And so that's my concern. And I know Mr. Detar, he's a outstanding citizen in our community, highly respected, and by this is by no means a reflection on Mr. Detar at all, but I think it's good business practice. That's what I'm concerned about. And you never know what could possibly go wrong on a project like this. And so that's my only comment on it.
With that one item, I think it's prudent, actually, to have the backup of the bond. In spite of the cost, Scott, if I heard right, you're kind of saying if the board wants it, you know, for sure, they should carry that expense, and that you'll fundraise.
I'll fundraise anyway, but yes. If I can't come up with that last $2,000, I don't want to be looked at like I failed.
Yes.
You know.
Well, I don't think anybody. You've succeeded already with the amount of money we've already raised, and the fact that the girder is here, and we're going to have this plaza.
But I made a commitment, and sort of Dave and even Wendy when she joined our committee, we really want this to be with no SFD dollars. And that means a lot to us, and we're really working so hard, and a great team, even the other, you know, committee members. We all have that as our priority goal. Mm-hmm. So we're working very hard. You know, we've raised a lot of money, like you see, but $2,000, I think we can do it, but I'm just concerned, you know.
Well, the only thing I would say is that's a cost of the project.
Okay.
I think I'm with you.
As long as we understand that, that's fine.
The idea of having it fall apart and not having that bond is too catastrophic.
And I understand what Tim's saying.
That's way too big a loss.
I think based upon your motion and what you're speaking to now and the comments you just made to Mr. Jablow, I the prerogative of the board, if you feel comfortable with that, I mean, staff is not going to say that, you know, our recommendation is looking at a bigger picture piece, having some experience, and we won't be in a bad place. And if you do approve it at the $65,000 contract, we remain the bond in place. Net, we'll do the best we can.
It certainly doesn't. It does not reflect on Mr. Detar at all.
No.
Every business can run into circumstances beyond their control, mm-hmm. and that would put us. That would give us the insurance that we could finish the project. Like you said, I have no qualms that he would finish the project either. But buying insurance has nothing to do with. The person has to do with the circumstances.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, if we're talking about the original amount from Detar, the full amount is $65,000 even?
No, $65,611.64.
Okay, mm-hmm. $65,611.64. Mm-hmm. And our responsibility to you to be zero would be $22,900.96 to be zero. That's where we're at.
Is that with some committed money you're speaking to?
That's what we've raised so far.
In the bank?
That's with what we have in the bank and what we have committed.
Okay, so it's the committed piece, we got to take that
right,
out of.
But,
so
okay,
I want to
be
clear.
That's only $4,700. So
you're about $27,000.
Right.
Yeah, I had 28.
Back to your 28.
Yeah.
Net.
27,647.
Okay. So we could say not to exceed $28,000.
I just want to get the right figure out there because.
Well, we also want to close the door. We want to say, okay, we'll cover 10, and we'll see how it goes. I don't want to do that. I want to make sure this project gets completed.
Right.
We're going to continue to, you're going to continue to fundraise. We're going to continue
every
to
day.
Get the project done.
Yeah.
But we're going to take this veil off of how do we start breaking ground, and where does the, we need to,
thank
we
you.
Need to progress.
Because if we don't, because of the curing time of the concrete, it could take, I think, 30 days that we didn't plan on originally. If we don't start by mid-June or whenever the tar is comfortable, we won't make that 9/11.
Right.
So.
Right. So you're looking for our input today, our decision
right.
today.
We'd like to move forward.
You know, the piece that I wanted to make sure about, and I checked with the chief about this, is just, is it legal for us as a fire district to build a memorial? To, if the worst case scenario is that you don't collect any more money and we front the $28,000, is that legal? And you've spoken with Mr. Whittington about this?
Correct, and he's been at all of our meetings here in this dialogue, so mm-hmm. I'm pretty confident that we're not out of bounds by any means.
Because this is a leasehold improvement to our property, right. We're already, mm-hmm. we already are spending the money, we're spending donations.
We're the owners of this property, we're the owners of the memorial, we'll facilitate
what
the,
we can't do is create some sort of a loan. We can't say that we're loaning money to the 9/11 committee. That's not, we're all the right. same entity. Right.
Correct.
So we're just discussing where the funds are coming from and opening up access to those monies, which we are going to spend regardless if we approve that bid.
Correct. And that money at this point would be a contingency item that we'll know at the end of the day whether it's coming out of this budget or next budget and what that number is. And if there's opportunity to continue to fundraise and things like that, there may be an opportunity for us if needed. Mr. Dattar, you know, maybe, you know, slow on getting us that last bill if we're a little bit, you know, there's a fundraising event coming up or something like that. He said he's willing to work with us for a small amount to kind of help facilitate, get to where we need to be. But today, the difference is last month we didn't know where that open check was going to be, where that ceiling was. Even if we would have opened up these bids and they all would have been $150,000, we weren't committed to the bids. We were just committed to some concepts, and we decided to hold off on those concepts. We wouldn't have awarded a bid today, if that's what you choose to do, at $150,000. It just wouldn't have happened, and we'd be back to the drawing board, and we'd have a whole different conversation going on. Because of where we are, we're trying to, A, approve the bid at $65,000. We understand where the fundraising component is to this piece, and we will be looking to make that exposure to the district as little as possible. But today, we know that number now is $28,000 less.
Or less.
Less than $28,000. That's the max.
It's clear it's going to be less. You are doing a phenomenal job.
The whole committee together. Mm-hmm. Everybody's doing
yes.
their own. They each have our own
that
special
team. That was a plural
you. Thank you.
All right, so I think we have a consensus that we're going to keep the bond. I think we're looking to approve the, it also, if we approve the bid as submitted, there's no question that we approved the bid as submitted.
Plus
we went to RFP, we got three bids, we're going to accept the low bid.
And it's nice to keep the lighting component in there, because the lighting component, it was the girder, just to explain, the girder was going to be lit downward. The lighting component that we're talking about is in the ground, in the pathway, that's up and looking at the We'll Never Forget and the 9/11. Mm-hmm. It's an integral part, but it was $7,000. We can keep that, it would really enhance it a lot better. It brings it up to another level.
Any other discussion? I've got a motion formulated here to do this. So I move to approve to accept the qualified bid submitted by Dattar Construction for the amount of $65,611.64, conditioned upon deductive change order to AIA contract 105-2007 as amended and approved by the fire chief. Further authorize the fire chief to execute the agreements in consultation with LEA and Dattar Construction to seek value engineering reductions of the project that minimize impacts to the design elements as originally submitted. And I also move to approve the allocation of $28,000 from the contingency account. I should say not to exceed $28,000 from the contingency account.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, let's break ground.
You bet.
Thanks, John. All right. So on to third-party consultant for leadership and team building. So this is something we've been talking about since late last year. Everybody's had a chance to review the three submissions from Arbinger, MSEC, and Real Change. And the summation that was provided by Chief Pachura. So we're going to open up the floor to kind of discuss where we'd like to go from here. It's sort of time to make a decision on, are we going to proceed with, and with whom are we going to proceed, and how are we going to proceed? Does anybody want to start?
I you know, in reviewing the three options, I do feel the best about the MSCC, I think those are the letters, because partly because they're a known entity, we've worked with them before, their budget is within reason. I think there may be, as if we meet with them, ways to even get the budget down by perhaps omitting a couple of pieces. But that's my, right now, that's the direction I see.
Okay. Any other comments? I will say that the thing I like about Arbinger, although they're the highest price, they do offer a train-the-trainer program. So essentially they would come in and train our organization to do what they're going to do the first time around. So it would be creating a program in perpetuity that would be administered to every new employee, that would be continually updated every year and would be an ongoing employee improvement and morale boosting program. So I understand the initial cost is higher. It's also an all-inclusive cost, and we know the number going in because it's a package cost. So MSEC, we have kind of an estimate based on if we choose MSEC, we're going to have to go back to them and say, okay, this is the parts of that we want. So we really don't know essentially what the cost is going to be. I totally agree we can go in and engineer the cost, mm-hmm. engineer what we want to do. Arbogen's program is sort of one-stop shopping. The idea is you take it, it's a very extensive program, and it will leave us in a position where the organization is trained and will continue to be able to foster the program without going back to do this again. And I can tell you that organizations, anybody who's worked for a big organization, know they do this every several years. They need a tune-up, so to speak. And they look to outside consultants to come in and help with morale, with team building, with structure, with organizational psychology and motivation and all the things that we're sort of looking for. I just see that could be an option where we don't have to go back to that again. We create a program that will continue.
Ty, I'm not familiar with Train the Trainer, and when I read about it, I wasn't clear. So could you just say a few more words as to why then it has in perpetuity, it just keeps on going on?
The idea would be the same as what we do with our own training programs. We used to send people constantly out to training programs, and then we realized that if we sent people to become trainers, we would do our own training programs, and people actually send their people to us to train them.
Okay.
So
thank you.
They would train, is it three people in this program, I think, that they will train to be certified in their program. Mm-hmm. So they will administer the program. Starting next year, they would administer the program, and the program would continue.
Now I understand. Thank you.
I'm not necessarily saying they're the they're the only one that has recommended a program that will continue beyond the short-term Band-Aid fix, so to speak. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
That assumes, Mr. Chairman, that those who you train stay consistently with the organization. You don't always know that.
That's true.
So you can train these trainers. I've seen this happen. You know, where you do a service like this, you train your trainers, two of them leave. You know, it just assumes that you retain those people.
But when you have a trainer, they could train another trainer. So you would have to lose all three at once to have to go back to the organization. You would be able to retrain people within your organization. I think that's why they probably said three, is that creates some level of backup protection, so to speak, is that you would be able to retrain people as it moves forward. If we're going going to spend the money on the program, I guess I'd like to see it be a long-term program, not something that's a Band-Aid on this year's problem.
Well, yeah, and I don't know if it's this year's problem as much as it's just an opportunity to provide organizational tune-up. As you stated, all organizations go through this. They have opportunities. I'm sure they've done it at the city. I'm sure they did it in L.A. I'm sure they did it in the school districts at the different levels or whatever, where people come in and provide this leadership training opportunities to motivate, challenge, and create opportunities for folks. I think that the it's really the legacy piece that's really important. So you pay for part of it, but that's the train the trainer and the legacy experience that we create, embrace, and move forward with. And that's part of the Arbinger piece. But I'd like to ask if Chief Paichiro has done most of the legwork on this, if he's got anything to add specific to either one of those two options.
As you noted, the Arbinger proposal creates a program for perpetuity and kind of carries it forward. It also offers online mentoring of the instructors to make sure that they're at the top of their game when they're presenting, and as well as linking employees that take the program in a system for continuous education and touching them, if you will, with relevant information continuously. It also offers annual assessments of the organization via that initial agreement. So every year they would do an assessment to see how the organization is adapting to the information being provided. And that's part of the contract piece that's in the package.
Every year, and that would be included in this price?
Yes.
Every year, forever?
It's an online.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they'll send out a link to all the employees in this group and ask certain questions relative to their mindset of organizational and personal think, if you will. And then they send those results to the leadership, and we review it to see what sort of tweaks we need to make and or adjustments. The MSEC program is one of those pieces where it's a limited group scope. It touches some of the employees, depending upon how much you want to buy into it and how many times you want them out here. They'll cover all of the employees, but that's one shot. And so as time goes on, some things will stick, some things won't. And we have some very talented people here that really understand information being provided to them. But as time goes on, sometimes we let things slide and slip. The Arbinger element is designed to stick with you and keep jabbing at you as you go through.
Well, it's the only one that would become a component of our orientation program. That's what we were talking about. It was $120 per hire, I think is what it was. So in the future, every person that comes on, for $120, they would get all the materials, and our trainers would put them through the 16 hours, I believe it is, of training in the program and organizational mindset. And so everybody has the same training. Everybody's on the same page. Whereas, if you were looking at MACC, you could literally be looking at come back and do this every year. If you want to do an organizational assessment, employee satisfaction, employee morale, motivation, any of the things that we're talking about, again, that's the only one that shows that they put a program in place that we're going to continue and will continue to work over time. Everybody else, the other two, just to me, and I originally was on the MSEC bandwagon. Mm-hmm. We've worked with them before. I know them, but when you're going to invest the money, I'd rather invest in a program that we're going to keep and it's going to continue over time.
What do we know about the Arbinger Institute? Is anybody familiar with
it? Well, one thing I'll add to that is, well, we do work with MSEC on a regular basis, and they provide great support as an HR adjunct to our organization. I'm sure they're highly skilled and capable, and if that's a choice that the board makes, I don't think you'll be coming with a substandard group coming to assist us in our adventure.
And Arbinger does.
But Arbinger is a public safety focused organization that comes and works. MSCC works with public entities too, so I'm not saying that they don't, mm-hmm. but their whole method and madness is a lot focused on that public safety piece, which has again additional added value to the program that I wanted to point out as well.
If I can add just a couple things. Not having worked with Arbinger, MSEC, or LLC was the third one.
Real change.
Yeah. So I don't know one from the other at all. But I know that within the fire service there is a culture, and sometimes that culture has to be modified, redirected, or changed. And reviewing the bid that Arbinger forwarded to us and looking at the personnel that they have, I was very comfortable knowing that they are kind of working from within for the members that we're concerned with, all of our membership, to address the very items that were a result of the survey. The train the trainer is extremely important. You do train those people that you target as the most responsible for the long term. And those are the ones that you're probably going to send as your trainers. There's a focus in here of a mindset going from an inward to an outward. And Arbinger addresses that where the other two didn't. And like I said, I was really impressed with their package that they forwarded to us. I think they addressed those items that we were looking for. And I think they projected a long-term program that we were interested in. But as I mentioned before, there's a culture within the fire service that those from within know, and if you're looking for an outside vendor to modify something, in my opinion, it's best to go with those that know what that culture is all about. And my vote would be for Arbinger.
Well, I was a little concerned. I like the Arbinger proposal the best. I am concerned about the overall cost, but I do note that, Chief, I believe you made a note here that says, can be reduced with a reduced scope of work. There might be some room for negotiation in the Arbinger proposal.
Yes, but it's mostly focused on the numbers of people that would attend sessions one and three. It was the group, the big group, the smaller group, and then there's the smallest of the trainers piece. So this is the first two sessions.
This is also the only proposal that hits every member of our organization.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Which part of said was important.
That is important.
Yeah, part of that adjustment is a minor. It's pay me now or pay me okay. $120 later when I catch those people.
We're looking at 44.8 then, really.
Plus the travel expense.
Plus the travel. And the breaking it down by the cost per employee, we're looking at a little under $500 per employee in the organization, which to me is a very reasonable cost to invest in your employees for something that's going to have a lasting benefit, an ongoing benefit to the organization.
Well, and their scope of work is basically a year, isn't it? I mean, this is not they're going to come in and do this in a month.
It's
10 weeks, it says.
Yeah, within 10 weeks, the fully delivered piece goes into play. But over that first year, there's coaching with the train the trainers, and then there's individual training or group training available for like the stations or the management team or those sorts of things through the package. And then every year there's that assessment element that comes into play to see how the organization is doing in its mindset.
And the other question on the cost per employee, I noticed with MSCC and Real Change that you can't really calculate the cost per employee because it's too variable to calculate. So could that number be as high as the cost per employee for Arbinger? Could those numbers be that high?
It could be depending upon the number of employees you touch, in the sense that it's going to be really difficult with Real Change, and they're premised upon focus groups, bringing the entire organization in and having these sessions with them. And we talked about Shift Life when I interviewed them. And they said, well, we can break it up. We won't charge you travel costs because they're coming out of Flagstaff area. But in the fire service, schedules are schedules are schedules, whether it's vacation, mm-hmm. hunting season, or something else going on, we're going to miss somebody. Mm-hmm. And it may be just a onesie-twosie, or it may be just five or six people, but they may be the critical people that you want to engage in an organization. The MSEC, it's a set number of sessions. Here's a presentation. Here's the book package piece that you would do, and we'll catch a segment of your organization, primarily gauged towards a selected group, policymakers, management, labor, and folks in between, but it's a segment. It's just a sampling of that. It's not an organizational-wide piece.
So on page three, just quick follow-up question, under the comparison table that you have there, under total number of employees impacted, Arbinger is all of the employees. MSEC is, it says can be all. It says can be all for MSEC and also for Real Change. So does that mean that the more employees that you add, the cost goes up for those two?
Yes.
Okay. Well, you know, hearing, understanding better what Arbinger has to offer, and also understanding that they're going to reach the entire workforce. I'm also in alignment with your suggestions, both of you, that it might be the better choice.
Well, I think Dave's absolutely right that you tend to put more weight on advice from somebody who does what you do. So I like Bill a lot, but I'm not a lawyer, so I listen to him because he's a lawyer, but I might not internalize because he doesn't do what I do. So somebody who comes in as an HR professional or a lawyer and tells you what to do, you may not internalize that as well as somebody who's been a fire captain or who's worked on the front lines or has run a battalion or has done what. So that's, I totally see what you're saying, Dave. That adds a huge value to the buy-in that we're going to get from the organization on the program.
So is this coming out of board funds, contingency funds?
Well, let's talk about that, because it's not going to come out of this budget year, likely.
Likely not.
No.
And so one thing I want to say, because if we get to the funding of this mm-hmm. project, I think it's important. So Board Member Ernster said, you know, would the cost for per employee be maybe near the same? In my head, I bet it is close to the same. If you look at a lower price but for less people, it's probably close to the same. So if we value all of our employees, we're willing to not just work on these folks, but we're working on the collective whole. The fact that if we plant a seed and we take an organizational culture and we began to cultivate that, the person that didn't get trained in some of these other avenues gets mixed into the fold, like we just did today with Captain Wells. Then we got to get them up to speed, or we got to do all the stuff, and then we're just putting them in an organizational leadership role, and we got to make sure he understands this open-minded, or the how they say that, open
mindset.
Piece of this, you know what I mean? So getting this wide across the whole organization really seems to make more sense on top of the other things we kind of talked about. Just understand that then as we move through the process, it's going to bubble up from the bottom up and the top down versus this group of folks that kind of, we got the secret handshake, we know what's going on, and people are looking around, what is that hocus pocus stuff you guys are talking about? Oh, it's really cool. It's this stuff they taught us, the five dysfunctional, you know, leadership pieces and whatever. I did that once in college. It's no big deal, you know, or whatever. I mean, so there's so much value to it. And I think there's, organizationally, I think the acceptance in the Arbinger model, hands down, will go really well, far more than it would in the MSEC model. Again, not that they won't provide good quality service, but we also use MSEC in other parts of our organization. And sometimes then we're going to meld those two. And like, you just came to us and talked to us about this thing, and that's your role, and now you're teaching us something else, where it kind of helps keep those two separate. And MSCC does a great job in what they're doing for us in that capacity that they provide us now. I don't want to confuse those two. And then Board Member Soto said about the internal, looking across the aisle and having someone, whether the police officer, firefighter, but they're in the public safety business, has a lot to say And so I think there's a lot of pluses in the Arbinger column from the funding standpoint. Again, these are just parts and pieces that kind of happen along the way. We're spending it somewhere. We're spending it in a good place, I think, on our team. And
so it would come out of next year's contingency?
Most likely would come out of next year's contingency, yes. There's certainly options, you know, that we need to get there. But at the end of the day, that's the last stop. There could be other opportunities.
Well, a portion of it can come out of this year's contingency, too, but it just depends on how soon they're going to start.
We're only
45 days away from
right. If we call tomorrow, I don't know what their start time is or what their first incrementing billing cycle is to get started on that. So there could be some that comes out of this year, and they're very well. It could all come out of next year. It just depends on what their model is.
How much is left in this contingency since we just committed more money?
40 oh. was 327, so we're at 287?
No, 299, right?
299.
Right.
After 40,
327 minus 28?
Minus 40 for the ambulance.
Oh, and the ambulance, I'm sorry. And the ambulance, correct. So it's going to be 259, 260.
So if you're going to, if you're going to call 28... not to exceed, if we just say it's going to be 28,
right.
So that's mm-hmm. 287 minus
260.
Mm-hmm. Well, you have until July 1st to get a bill from these people if you want to go with Arbinger.
Correct.
But yeah, the issue is you want to pay the whole bill up front before they start the scope of work. So
no, but
to
you might want to pay.
And they may not want
a portion.
Yeah,
I totally agree.
Yeah, they may be willing
all
to take. Okay, well, thank you.
So it just depends on if they can start work in June, which is, that might be tough.
Fire season.
Yeah. Well, and not to mention that's tough for us.
Yeah.
Well, it's tough for us. There's a few components. We may talk to them and say, listen, we have a new HR manager starting. We've got a new fire marshal we're expected to start. We may want this team, you know, we may not want it to start till August until we get all the people in place. I mean, it's just, there's whatever they say and whatever we do, but there may be some key components that we want to.
Now, it can come out of next year's contingency, but there's also potential that we've got with some retirements and with losing some positions until they're refilled, we're going to have some potential monies available in HR and fire marshal budget, or is that not necessarily true?
I'm not sure about HR necessarily, but there could be some in the finance budget down the road. There are a lot of variables that need to be looked at in the short term and long term, but there's certainly some opportunities. There's an election coming up. If for some reason the election was uncontested and we didn't spend the $50,000 or $60,000 in the budget that's earmarked for the election, that would cover this cost. I mean, there's, and there very well may be an election. So I don't know that for another couple, you know, until the deadlines hit, but we'll know that soon. And there's a multitude of opportunities for us to find some opportunities to invest in our folks.
Worst case, it could come all out of contingency of next year. Best case, some could come out of this year's contingency if they can start service, or we can find line items on areas where we have some retirements or other areas with money that's freed up that we could pull money over without changing our budget for the next year.
Correct.
Okay.
I think we've said since late last fall, early winter, when all this started to go down, we were committed to making investment in our people, getting rid of this line between management and staff, that we all want to be on the same team and that we're committed to putting our money where our mouth is to make that happen. Today, I guess, is the day that we're going to, mm-hmm. it comes down to it. We've done the groundwork. We found what I think are the right people. I think we have the funds to do it within the next fiscal year. I think we should commit to do it with them. So I'm going to go ahead and move. I move to approve the RFQ submitted by Arbinger and authorize that the fire chief and assistant chief implement the contract and direct finance to budget the expenditures for next fiscal year, either out of contingency or the appropriate budget where funds are available.
Second.
Do we need to mention the amount in this motion?
That's fine. It's what's the travel component, Jeff?
You don't know.
It's $44,800. Yeah, it's in there.
No, it's plus travel.
Plus
so
travel.
It really depends upon who's traveling from where to here and. So, yeah.
Well, we can put a not to exceed on it.
Well, or you can just put plus travel, the cost
okay,
plus
so
travel.
Okay, so I'll amend the motion to $44,800 plus travel.
I second.
Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. OK. Okay, thank you, everybody. That's been six or seven months coming to get to that point. I appreciate everybody's work. Chief, I appreciate your hard work getting all that collated.
You bet.
And we look forward to working with them. Okay, this is Diane Schoen's last meeting.
That's true.
That part is true. We will miss your cookies.
Yeah, well, there's a few over there that need to be eaten tonight. Okay.
We'll make sure we take care of them before we grab you one. Want to say definitely thank you, Diane, for stepping up and for your time on the board and for all our interesting times together, and we really appreciate your input and your time you've committed to us. I think the chief has something.
Yeah, I would like to say from staff, Diane, we do appreciate your dedication and your passion for the fire service, the fire Sedona Fire District specifically. I think that you've been a consummate professional, dedicated to the citizens of our community. You've got a keen eye for all the great things that come into the nuances of being a board member, and I was always and always will be amazed by the things you brought to me that you noticed or saw, observed, the kind little gestures and ways I could help move my career along, if you will. And for that, I'm personally grateful for that you've brought to me. But I know the rest of the staff has enjoyed working with you and appreciates all of your insights as it relates to all your motions and all your comments that you've made at all your board meetings. And so we appreciate that.
Thank you.
We have a brick for you.
Great.
One that is out in front of the station. I don't know if it's installed yet, but it will be soon.
And they're looking at each other like, who's going to do that?
It's being done soon.
Yeah.
Coming to a patio near you. But it says Diane Schoen, SFD Governing Board 2012 to 2016, just a way to remember your dedicated service to our organization. You'll be forever memorialized in that patio out front there as people walk by and see that. We have this brick for you to take and head down to Phoenix with.
Thank you. It's been an honor to serve on the board, and I know the board will go forward and make great decisions, and we'll work hard and we'll represent the community. Particularly when it comes to safety and to our fiduciary responsibility and how hard you all work. I will be here from time to time in the community, so you never know, I might drop in with some cookies. You never know.
Bring cookies. Well, with that said, we need to turn our attention to filling her seat. We had open applications. We've received four very qualified applicants. Everybody's received their information, so we need to decide as a board how we'd like to proceed with interviewing these candidates. Mm-hmm. I suppose if we want to set a special meeting, how we want to proceed.
Mm-hmm. Chairman, you guys went through this recently, so you have got a very clear memory of how we did that last time as we filled the spots here. And well, I guess Tim took the spot and then Dave made the list, so to speak, and so I turn it really to you and how you wanted to handle that with having just four candidates. You know, there was, I think we had four last time, so you interviewed them all and had your process, and how you wanted either.
I think it's just going to be a matter of finding a time that we can mm-hmm. all mm-hmm. meet.
This, this time, you know, we might consider interviewing all four at once.
I agree. Mm-hmm. And maybe schedule a half hour for each.
Uh-huh. That seemed to be right.
Timing-wise, I'm not sure. We've got a short time till our next board meeting, because it's a week early next month. It might be tough to get. Although, if we can get the interviews done, I suppose we could make a decision at the next board meeting. So, I guess the question is there any time that we can pick to meet in the next few weeks, and that we could come to a date and we can check and see if the candidates are available?
Certainly with a little bit of advance notice for those folks to amend their calendars as such is a nice thing, but it's certainly at your pleasure what's good for you, and hopefully they can make it, and if they can't, that's for them to prioritize, I guess.
Did we Last time we did it on a weekday. We did it like late in the afternoon.
Yes. Mm-hmm. By the way, yeah, I think over 2 days.
Mm-hmm. That's true. With offering one day, we risk that one of those applicants can't make it.
Well, yeah, that's true. Let's start with what days of the week is anybody not available, I guess? Is anybody at absolute zero for a certain day?
I'm not available May 29th through June 1st. That's 4 days. I'm not available. But other than that, I'm good.
What does everybody think about Thursdays?
They're good.
Thursday, late Thursday afternoon, 3 o'clock start time. Mm-hmm. Maybe Thursday the 2nd or Thursday the 9th.
Thursday the 9th is the is an event,
okay,
such as this one.
Thursday the 9th, that gives us, that's 1 week before our board meeting.
Oh,
I'm sorry, Thursday the 2nd. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's second. I'm tied up on the 9th.
On the 2nd, though?
On the 2nd? No, I'm free on that day.
June 2nd?
I'm good.
June 2nd, 3 o'clock. We'll check with our candidates and see if...
Yeah.
If we go 0-4, mm-hmm. or, I mean, if nobody can...
we can make those...
You might want to have an alternate date over here.
Let's try that first before we get too confused. Let's offer them one date, and if somebody absolutely can't make it, we can coordinate. If we're going to try and do it in one day, I hate to say, we're going to do it in one day, but here are 2 dates to choose from.
Okay. Yeah, and you may find that one candidate can't make it, and that just may... be the way it is, or if you decide that if someone can't make it, you'd like to make an alternate date, that's, again, your prerogative to how you choose to do that.
We can sort of coordinate this by email with you, I would say, Tricia, but she's...
Yeah.
It's not entirely easy. I'm just wondering, while we're all here now, if we don't have to talk about the second date, but just to see if our schedules go for the following Wednesday, that would be the 8th. If we need a second time to meet. I sure would like to interview all four.
Okay. I could do same time Wednesday the 8th.
Uh-huh.
My calendar shows me being tied up all day from 8 to 4. Mm. But I can confirm that. Let's make sure that that's still the case.
Mm-hmm. And it could be 4, you know, because it might be just one person that we're catching up with on that day.
How about Tuesday the 7th?
In the afternoon, 3 p.m.?
Same thing.
That'd be better.
Let's make that our alternate day, but let's start with Thursday the 2nd, because it's a little...
The 7th at 3 o'clock is the second date, if needed, not preferred.
So yeah, let's offer all the candidates the first date and see where we get to.
Great.
All right, 3 o'clock. You want 3 o'clock, half-hour interviews, 15 minutes in between, just to give you time to whatever you got to do. Not half-hour on the half-hour you want to do.
And it gives us a little margin.
Right.
We think that's fine.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think that works. What we did before. Okay, perfect. Diane, you gave us work to do.
Yeah, I'm done June 1st.
That's right. All right. Okay, so we will check with the applicants and go from there. Fees for legal services, I got the update this morning. It was $3,700. But he said there was an adjustment he was looking at that would be in our favor, so I don't have a final number. However, that still keeps us well under our budget for legal fees for the year.
I'm sorry, he gave you a number or did not?
He gave me a number of 37 something, yes. But he said there was an adjustment to be made that would be in our favor.
Okay.
He was looking at it.
Yeah, that was a while ago, and I thought we got another email today, and I was trying to look for it just now. I can't find it, but with an actual number, which is pretty close to that. So.
Okay.
For 375786 is actually the number that he
That's
provided today.
Okay.
So we're at 34,681 is the year to date budget through April.
Was this a 40,000 year budget or 60,000 budget?
60,000 I think is what it was. I think we moved next year to 50. No, I think next year's 50, I think.
Okay. All right, Gary?
Well, you know, some of the times I talk about is lessons learned. And the chief talked earlier about the brush fire that we had out in the village, in which the winds were blowing, and he just kind of pulled it out of that wash and put it across that open lot and ended up impacting that home. And you know, we talk about defensible space and how important it is, but I think that we also need to be remember those who have flat roofs have debris on top of them. That's exactly what happened in this particular case, built up in the corner. Embers, which is primarily what's going to propagate that fire, ended up impacting it and got into the truss space. So it's just as a reminder, while defensible space is very important, we also need to make sure that we check our gutters and our roof. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Gary and Sandy will be saying our congratulations before you go. I assume this is not the last meeting.
Oh, no. Well, no, we'll see June and July for sure.
Okay. Good. All right.
Well, if they show up.
If they show up. Extended vacation before retirement. All right. Thank you, everybody. We're adjourned.
Folks, just saying real quick, just so you know, I do think we do sing a little song of happy birthday to